So, successful? You see, beings like Dhammasopa Rinpoche, apart when they are focused on emptiness, they always do Tonglen. And without effort, spontaneously, they always do that. No? His Holiness Dalai Lama, all these high lama, they're always in that state. And whatever they say, whatever they think, whatever they do, it comes out of that mind. So it's a, you know, we do like that, you know. But actually it's a very advanced state. You know, to be successful, you realize that you need a certain level of calm abiding. You need a certain level of having given up your mental afflictions. Because if you have strong mental afflictions, not possible. Or strong self-centeredness, you know, strong me, 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 my happiness, my pleasure, my problem. You know, if you're strongly focused on you, it's difficult to put your mind out there and care for all being. So you must have a certain level of having pacified your own mental affliction to be successful. And then on top of that, you have to realize that that's the way to go. There's not a meditation that is better than that. There's not a meditation that is, how to say, quicker to reach enlightenment than that. You have to realize that's it. That's the main practice. You see, without that, you don't enter the Mahayana path. You might have other qualities. You might realize emptiness. But you're not yet on the Mahayana path. You're not yet on the path to enlightenment, to Buddhahood. The prerequisite is this mind. That's where there is the dedication, you see. May the precious jewel of Bodhichitta that has not yet been born be born, and that which has been born never degenerate but increase forevermore. What it speaks about is exactly that emotion in your heart, that caring attitude for all living beings. So this is a warmth in your heart, you see, a feeling of well-being. It's like the center of your being, you know. Some would call it the soul, you know. Why not? Is this warm light in your heart, this soft spot, so to practice, one gives birth to this soft spot in one's heart. At the beginning, there's no soft spot there, it's only empty space. You know? What are you talking about, a soft spot in the heart? But to practice, you see, to purification, taking the 8 Mayana precepts, purifying the mind, and then meditating gradually, you have this genuine warm heart that is born. And most of us, we have experienced it fleetingly, you know, in our life, due to the blessing of some teacher or to, you know, being in love with somebody. So there's a similar feeling at the heart level. So it's a precious jewel, you know, in your heart, that you want to give birth to. And then it's like a small flame, you know, when you start a fire in the forest, you know, you start with some branches, a fire. At the beginning, it's very fragile. So your bodhicitta is very fragile. So you have to pay it very special attention and nourish it and feed it so that it doesn't die out. There's a very nice practice to do, you know. You sit at the terrace of a cafe and you sip a coffee, and you do tonglen on all the people that pass around. You know? You try to see each one as your beloved brother, sister, parent, friend, and you do tonglen on them. Or you walk down the streets, a busy city, no, and you do tonglen on all the people. So that's once you have certain mastery of it. You see, at the beginning you get completely distracted by your other thoughts and you lose it. So all the happiness there is in the world, up to enlightenment, comes from this mind that cherishes other, that loves other, that has compassion for other. in a text by Chandrakirti, it says, you see, what is the cause of the arhats and the pratikyeka Buddha, or the solitary realizer? So what produces them? And it says, well, they arise from the teaching of the Buddha. Their cause is Buddha's teaching. And then what's the cause of the Buddhas? The cause of a Buddha is the Bodhisattva. So it's the Bodhisattva path that makes us become Buddha. And what's the cause of a Bodhisattva? It's compassion, Bodhichitta, and the wisdom of non-duality, emptiness of inherent existence. So these three are the cause of a Bodhisattva: compassion, the mind of enlightenment, and non-duality. So you need all three to become a Bodhisattva. And then Chandrakirti says, but the main one of the three is compassion. Compassion is the seed. It's like a seed. You see, without compassion, without the seed, there's no flower to come, there's no plant to come. You need a seed. So he says, without compassion, there's no path to enlightenment. So compassion is like a seed at the beginning, you see. We need this compassion. And then he says, at the middle, compassion is like water. You see, like a water for a plant. So without compassion, our spiritual qualities don't grow. You see, without water, the plant doesn't grow. So without cultivating compassion in the middle of our spiritual training, our qualities will not grow. And at the end, the compassion is like the flower of the plant, you know. So it's the compassion that produces beautiful flower of enlightenment and benefit all beings, make all beings happy. So therefore, Chandrakirti says, compassion is indispensable at the beginning, at the middle, and near the end of the path. You see, when you are a high bodhisattva, what makes you complete the path to enlightenment, again, is compassion. You see, you might be happy with your realization, with your insight into emptiness, with your quality. You know you're not going to take a bad rebirth. You have some kind of control over your mind. So you can kind of get complacent, you know, satisfied. So what makes you go further is compassion. Because you cannot bear to see the suffering of living beings and you want to help them. So you want to remove the last veil from your mind. there's so much pain, you know. So many people have physical pain. Some people have almost continuous pain. So I used to be florist before being monk, and I used to deliver flowers in hospitals. And you see rows and rows and rows of bed now with sick people in it. Now, what people in the West don't know is that suffering is the wrapping of karma. So it doesn't happen by chance, at random. It is not sent you by God for a test, or it is not the work of a devil being. Evil being. From Buddhist point of view, it's the ripening of karma, of negative karma we create in past life. So when we have this compassion to help others, we have compassion for their suffering, but also for the cause of suffering. You see, if we want to help other people, we have to prevent them from creating negative karma. Once the suffering has happened, once the karma has ripened, it's difficult to change. You can purify karma before it ripens, but once it's ripened, somehow one has to experience it. So that's why people with, you know, some knowledge, they try to help other people prevent them from creating negative karma that produce suffering, and try to encourage them to create good karma that produce happiness. So that's what the lamas, you know, they teach all the time. Karma, you know, if you want to be happy, take care of your karma. So if we want genuinely to help others, we have to be skillful and try to induce them to create positive karma and avoid negative ones. So if you genuinely love someone and you don't want him to suffer, you have to be skillful to teach him to avoid creating the cause for it. And that's not easy, because people don't believe in karma, they don't believe in rebirth. So one of the Buddha qualities, skillful mean, is to understand the other person and to be able to come across, you know, to be able to help them in their own language, in their own worldview. So when Lama Zopa Rinpoche teaches, that's mostly what he teaches, you see, how to become a better person, how to stop creating negative karma, how to create virtue. So to help someone is not easy. That's why, unless you have a bigger picture, it can be very discouraging. If you only think this life, that you only have this life to help that person. Then sometimes not possible. But you will try again next life, and the life after, and the life after. And at some point, the person's mind will be open and ready to listen to you. So we have to see our help for living being in terms of infinite lives. Then, the compassion, you see, finds way to help. At a certain moment, a person will be ready to listen. So that's what the Buddhas do, you see. Buddhas are not omnipotent. They can only show us the way, they can only teach us karma, compassion, so forth. We have the free will to listen and follow, and we have the free will to say, no, that's not for me. And that's true for us, for the people around us in our life. We can share our wisdom, we can share our compassion, our love. But whether people accept it or not, it's their choice. But the Bodhisattva and the Buddha will never give up until the last living being is out of suffering. He will never give up trying to help all beings and lead them to enlightenment.
Yeah, bye.